We're good. All right. Well, good evening and welcome to the Circus Historical Society's Circus History Live. Tonight's program will feature the history of the nerveless Nock with Michaelangelo Nock. And now here's your host, CHS Vice President and Historian Chris Berry. Chris?
Thank you, Bruce. You know, the term circus royalty is sometimes used to describe those whose families have performed for generations. And today we're joined by somebody whose family first achieved fame well over 100 years ago, both in Switzerland and Italy, his mother and his father. And even today, the Nock family continues to dazzle audiences around the world with amazing feats. Michaelangelo Nock, who's our guest today on Circus History Live, grew up in the circus, as did his parents and even their grandparents. Since 1840, the Nock family has been thrilling audiences. And today, we're privileged to have Michaelangelo Nock as our guest on Circus History Live. Michaelangelo, welcome, and thanks for joining us today.
Thank you very much. I'm honored, and thank you for interviewing me and all the guests. I was looking at the list. Man, I'm nervous. all my friends and people I look up to, thanks for coming out.
Well, thank you. And, you know, let's just kind of get right into it here. And let's take a look at what was going on back in, I think everybody can see this here. This is a scene outside of a circus tent in Switzerland a while back. And I think that's your grandfather there standing inside of the tent with, looks a little nervous.
Yeah, the late 1930s in the Swiss Alps, Switzerland's original circus, Circus Nock. My grandfather, you know, you can just read his face. He's got his cigarettes. He's got his office people around him, and it looks like it's raining. And he's probably worried. He probably sent the still walker out there. Get out there and get some attention for the show. But now, isn't it great? It's a classic.
So how did your family get started in the circus?
I don't really know that. It probably, you know, in the theater, 1770. I've got a couple books. This is a rare book, The Windows of Switzerland. I've got some props, see? And this is the history of Switzerland from the, you know, from the start of Switzerland. The only circus that's mentioned is the Nock family. And they would do outdoor shows, you know, in the center of town. And then it evolved into
kind of like wandering minstrels back in those days, I guess. Huh?
Yeah, I mean, it's great. I mean, the crazy thing is some of the acts, like the low wire act, I still own it. And I have pictures of it from 1840. That wire act was on Ringling as the Daring O'Donnells. And then it was on Roy Disney's Disney on Parade as the Daring O'Donnells. And now I use it for special events. I'm not very good at it, but I love this rigging. And I keep it all, you know, in its own box and treat it like it's, you know, of course it's a family heirloom.
So this next picture here, now that's your father on the left there, right? And your uncle?
Yeah, he must be like 12 years old. My dad dressed up as a clown on their show. My uncle Artur, and then once my father came to America, our uncle became a Circus Kinney's mascot. His name was Keneally the Clown.
And he's associated with Circus Kinney for so long. And of course, your father came over to join Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey in 1954.
Right.
How did John Ringling North find them?
You know, they were working, I believe, at Haringey Arena, all these big events in London. And I think it was John and Henry who went, you know, searching for acts. And they did several acts. They did the balancing ladder. It's funny, the Europeans, they were the nerveless Nocks or the Nocks, the three Nocks on sway poles. But their wire act was called the Daring O'Donnells. And then the balancing ladder, the aerial ladder, was the Rixos, like a Spanish name, like they were disguising themselves.
One family in multiple acts, yeah. Right? So just to kind of give folks a little idea here of what the circus tent looked like back in Switzerland. I mean, this looks like it's somewhere in the Swiss Alps. You can see that the homes around the circus tent. Did your dad used to talk about this those days?
Yeah, all the time, all the time. And that's how the sway poles evolved. You would set up the tent, you know, and then they would have to climb the tent mast. And they got good at that. And then they put that little circle up there. There you go. And they took it outside. And to entice the people to come in and see the show, a little free show.
And, so now these poles were made out of wood, right?
Made out of Swiss fir trees, yes.
Wow. Tall
and, trees. So those are the poles that were on Ringling Brothers Circus. So my father came with the USS United States, the fastest ship liner at the time, right? His first date was Madison Square Garden. So you got these high poles. Then they start to tour on the train and the then on in the tent. So they had to be shorter, and they got to the show one day, and somebody had cut the poles. And my uncle Charles, who was the leader of the family, the owner of the Nock family, he was upset. Oh, they cut the poles, but they did a good job because it fit exactly where they needed it.
So this next picture shows your dad, your uncle,
yes,
and your aunt, right?
Ringling Brothers. So that's dad on the left, Elizabeth, and Charles, and you know there's working guys in the back. So my aunt was amazing woman. She could do whatever her brothers could do. She also did. They called it the Sprung. It was a platform, and it was before bungees, and there was a trapeze like 20 feet out, and she did it on Ringling. And she would do a Lear act, then she would get on this platform, and then they said she's going to leap to this trapeze 20 feet out. But they had woven these ropes around her ankles that the audience didn't see. She slaps the trapeze, it breaks, and she falls to the oh, wow. ground, you know, just barely making it and swinging. So, you know,
so, you know, 1954, when your family came to the Ringling Circus, this was a time, you know, after the war, there were a lot of acts that were coming in. And one of those acts that came in came from Italy. Tell us a little bit about your mother's family.
The Canestrellis. Yeah, mom came from Italy. And there was an agent called Medini. I think he was one of John Ringling's talent scouts. And my mother was in Austria working at her aunt's circus. And the Rebenig, Circus Rebenig. And there they are right there. That's why the poster is in German. World class. The Canestrellis, unsupported ladders. So that's Uncle Oreste Canestrelli, my mother, and Pietro. And you know, that was their act, yeah.
When you take a look at, and there they are right there.
There they are.
When you take a look at that act, and this is in Madison Square Garden, I think this is 1956. And I mean, your uncle who's down there, when you look at his feet, yes. I mean, what an act this is.
Well, what a talented, super strong guy he was. He's supporting the whole family. They got my Literally. Mom doing a handstand, Uncle Oreste doing a headstand. What was nice about these European families, they brought their mother, my mother's grandmother, Olga. They're not going to leave anybody behind. Everybody's coming. They're going to stay together. We're going to stick together. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah, it's a great act. Obviously, it got her ready to go up on the sway pole, I guess, too, right?
It got her ready, yeah. You know, her grandmother was Olga was very nice to her. She grew up with my grandmother and her grandmother, my great-grandmother, and she taught her ballet. She taught her so many things, riding a horse, bareback riding. So as soon as my mom came to America, Justino Loyal put her in the act, the Loyal Rapinskis. My mom became the top mount of the pyramid. So, you know, as a circus performer, hey, put her in the act.
You know, when... obviously, today, everybody who's on this call has seen the Nock Sway Pole Act, but when they came in 1954, nobody had ever seen anything quite like that, right? I mean, you know, you can look, this is a page from one of the couriers that was put out that year, and top billing, I mean, bigger than John Ringling North.
It was great. It was great. My dad was so proud of this. I think I bought this poster from you or Tim Teggy. My dad always would say, hey, when we came to America, our name was bigger than Ringling Brothers. And I was like, oh, man, I'd love to see that one day. And so when John Ringling North would promote the act as a palm tree swaying in a hurricane. And then that makes me think, man, John and Henry must have hung out here in Sarasota in a hurricane like we just did, right?
So 1956 was not only a big year in circus history, but it was also a big year in the Nock family history also, right?
Yeah, absolutely. 56, well, mom and dad met on Ringling.
Yep.
They think they started dating at the Boston Garden. And one of the stories my father told me was between shows, everybody would go out to lunch. But my two uncles, the Canestrellis, they were hard on my mom. So my mom was training on the Washington, the head balancing trapeze. They call it the Washington. So these guys sent her up with a safety and they tied it. And they said, yeah, just keep practicing. We're going to lunch. Oh, my gosh. So my dad's looking for my mom already. And he goes, hey, Aurelia, you want to go to lunch with me? She goes, if you untie me.
That's hilarious.
But if we back up a little bit, how we got the name the Nerveless Nocks, it was the Queen of England, and it was 1954 at Haringey Arena, and I showed you that program earlier. It was Tom Arnold's Haringey Arena show, and then after the show, you know, the Queen said, "You're simply nerveless." That's our name.
Man. So the Queen of England was responsible.
It's well known that she loved the circus.
Yes, she did.
She loved circus animals. She loved animals in general. Yeah.
So so then the family started. And this is an early picture. You got started. Bello's not even, I guess,
no, at this point. Probably my mom would have had him in the picture, but he's not even...
With the suspenders over there.
That's me, the nerdy kid right there, and then Eugene up top, and then John.
You know, it's really interesting, and you and I have talked about this in the past. You know, circus families over the years would hand down their skills generation to generation, but so many of these European acts have not continued. But everybody in that picture, and Bello, who's not in the picture, you've continued in the circus. Why do you think that is? I mean, did you ever have any other aspirations to do anything else?
You know, and it's funny, I'll answer that, but it's funny because if we did any circus we always performed at, we always headlined, or it was, you know, the Elephants, the Nerveless Nocks, and then Hugo Zucchini. He would close the show. But then there's not, remember how big the Zucchinis were?
Sure.
Icons, they were everywhere. Like you said, nobody took it up. They're doing something else, you know.
And there's still Christianis who are performing, but you know, when you think about the fact that, you know, when they came over here in the 1930s, there were a lot of Christianis that came, and there aren't that many that are performing now. But the Nocks who came over, you're also performing, and you've taken it to the next generation also.
Yeah, next generation, and then so to answer your question, I know that Eugene wanted to be a pilot, so he became a pilot. And then we, our idols were Jim Grogan and Dave Merrifield. And then we started doing, in the early 90s, the helicopter trapeze act. And I had to do numerous air shows all over the country before Tommy Bartlett would even look at us. You had to prove, because he was a military flight instructor. And then he came to me one day, you know, after going on the road, doing all these air shows. Hey, Mike, would you like to do your helicopter trapeze act at Tommy Bartlett show? Sure. Let me ask my brother. Yeah. So
that's how it started.
Yeah, that's how it started. You know,
we're going to take a look at that in just a couple of minutes. But right now, you know, 1964, the Beatles had made their first appearance in the United States, and they came back. Ed Sullivan took the show down to Miami, and the show was a really big show. because you took them out to Hialeah racetrack, right?
Right on. Hialeah, some little act was there called the Beatles also.
So the Beatles and the Knox were on the show, yeah. And let's take a quick look at that.
Ladies and gentlemen, here against this background of my Seminole friends is one of the prodigious acts of world show business. From Switzerland, the nerveless Knox, and let's have a tremendous hand, won't you, for them?
They were experimenting. They were way too high. If you look at their faces, my family was very nervous. They were just too high. They were 90 feet. And
I mean, you think of 90 feet, that's almost a third of a football field tall.
And there's no guy wires. You know, guy lines are nothing. And we still use the same concept.
So how did your father design these so that they didn't flip over when they were up there?
Well, flip over. Well, these had the stakes down below, so they would set these big poles up like you set up a circus tent, you know, with a gin pole. You set them up and drive many stakes in the ground. But that appearance started a domino effect. Roy and Walt Disney saw the act and hired my parents for the 64-65 New York World's Fair, where, you know, everybody worked together. Jim Henson's Muppets, Sid and Marty Croft, Tommy Bartlett, the Zucchinis, and John Ringling North had a show there, the tent show.
So you mentioned the Disney show. Now, this picture here shows two groups of the family, and it looks like you're getting ready to go someplace.
We're going on the world tour leg of Disney on Parade, the original, you know, arena show. And I noticed on the list, Casey Gibbs is on tonight, and he's one of the pioneers, legends of Disney on Parade. How you doing? Good to see you.
But that's brother, like, and brother of Bobby Gibbs too, right?
Yes, yeah, big, well, you know, circus legends, wonderful people. We grew up with the family on the Disney show, Casey Gibbs. So that's
who are we looking at here? Just because you know, there's a lot of Knox there in that picture.
It looks like the Partridge Family, but so that's Eugene on the left, Eugene Jr., Charles Knox, the leader. Founder of the Nerveless Knox, his daughter Rebecca, John, the most talented brother, I think. John can do, is just a great acrobat. You know, he can do anything, this guy. That's my Aunt Dorothy with that beautiful hairdo. Check that out.
Yeah.
Mom right there, the blonde lady who looks like Lady Gaga, 50 years before Lady Gaga. And there's Bello. Look at that hair. And there's me. I don't know what I look like. I look
You're kind of got a page boy thing. I like that. And your shirt matches your brother John's too.
Twins, you know, that's Disney hired us. You guys are not twins, but you're going to be in my show as the Lost Boys. And there's Dolly Knock. And the way we're dressed, my mom was amazing, you know, traveling around the world. My mother would always dress us, take care of us. And I don't know how she did it because we were brats. I mean, you know, but she kept us in order.
Perform a couple of.
Yes, and she performed, you know.
Yeah. So your mother, you know, you talk about Disney, and I know that was sort of one of those first big events that the Knox got involved with, big, you know, Disney, yeah. The Disney shows, Disney on Parade. This particular photo here is your mother is, I guess, Wendy, right, in Peter Pan?
Yes, she's Wendy. And you know, it all came back. I said it on her obituary. Her grandmother taught her ballet as a child. So then, you know, the producer, Michael Gorillakis, you know, Roy Disney, they had like 100 of the world's best ballet dancers. And my mother fit right in. And
so
you know,
what did she do in the show? I mean, did she do circus acts?
Well, actually, Roy Disney and Michael Gorillakis, these producers of the show, they had Dumbo Circus. And in that circus was Daring O'Donnell, my mom and dad doing the wire act. So many different, Merle Cook's Comedy Car was in the show. Chuck Burns, one of the original Ringling Brothers. Barbette was the aerial director. We would always hang out with Barbette. And so they hired Casey Gibbs, you know, all these people with all this knowledge of the circus industry. And there's
the Lost Boys there, right?
The world tour of Peter Pan. And that's John and myself. And yeah, that was a fun show. We traveled. We went to Bangkok, Thailand, Hong Kong, Australia, Singapore. And again, you know, working with the best dancers in the world, and it was the greatest experience.
So the sway pole, how old were you when you first went up the 80 feet?
Yeah, it was 1981 at the Tommy Bartlett show. And that was my first time performing. The day show, there was three shows a day, 1, 4:30 and 8:30. And I always practiced and performed in the day show, but the night show was scary because, you know, you had the super troopers in your eyes. And in those days there was, you know, 6,000-7,000 people in the audience, but you couldn't see them. Oh, that I was scared.
So the Tommy Bartlett show, for those who don't know, Wisconsin Dells, longtime water thrill show up there. And how many years were you guys involved with that?
It was like 45 years, 45 years, three generations. Yeah, we started, Dave Merrifield was working there, the helicopter trapeze act. So Tommy Bartlett is now gonna open a second show in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee in 1978. And so Dave Merrifield's going to Pigeon Forge. So he recommends our family. But Tommy knew my father from the World's Fair because Tommy had the Florida Citrus Water Ski Show there at the New York World's Fair. So there you go. It was amazing. Me and my three brothers, my mother and father worked there all the way up till 92, 93. And then from 93 to 2019, my wife Carolina Spagna and my daughter and my son worked there. I got to do every act imaginable. You know, it was just
let's take a look. Let's go back in time a little bit to Pigeon Forge, and we're gonna see how the Nerveless Knocks looked back at Tommy Bartlett in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee, right now.
That's right.
90 feet above the air with absolutely no net to save them. Well, tonight we're going to watch one of their memorable performances in Tennessee.
Watching them come down is breathtaking. And seeing them swaying on top of the 100-foot flimsy poles isn't much easier on the heart. You're watching the Nock family, more accurately known by their stage name, the Nerveless Knocks. At Tommy Bartlett's Water Circus in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee, you'll find the Knocks, mother, father, and four sons, in some places not just everyone would go. Like Eugene Jr. and Michelangelo, high atop a wire on a motorcycle and a moving trapeze. Or Johann doing handstands over some precariously balanced chairs. 13-year-old Bello riding a unicycle across a wire. But the centerpiece of the act is the sway poles, which everyone but the youngest boy, Bello, balances on three times a day, 7 days a week, rain or shine. And 100 feet up there, not one mistake is allowed.
Well, you're dead. You know, there's no doubt about that. Any one of these acts. This act here goes up to 150 feet above the water. This one here is 100 feet off the water. Your body just can't take that kind of impact.
He was a nice guy.
One of the reasons the Knocks can face danger so gracefully is that their family has been doing this kind of work for seven generations. The Nock family circus began in Switzerland way back in 1840, and the tradition has survived unbroken until now, even in this branch of the Nock family, which moved to America. Mrs. Nock, Aurelia, comes from six generations of circus people in Czechoslovakia and Italy. She feels fortunate that none of her family has been hurt.
No, thank God, no. But to my brother-in-law, it did, and my nephew. Yeah, they do the same. We used to be all the family together, and the pole snapped. And he landed, luckily, he landed to a big net and a cage of lions. And so he broke his knee, but it was... I mean, it broke the fall, you know what I mean? So I was lucky. So.
With such a strong family tradition, you think the boys wouldn't have a choice to do anything else but perform up in the air.
Well, there's no pressure on it. You can no pressure nobody to go up on those poles up on a high wire. When you go up there, you have to be relaxed, with nice, with ease, you know? You cannot go with scare up there. Your muscles don't balance when you're tight.
I sometimes get scared, yes. At night, you know, sometimes you can't see things. It gets a little slippery from the rain, so you're more cautious. But I guess I worry more for my brothers and my mom or whatever. Because I get scared for them.
Not all the Knocks took to this work equally. Eugene Sr. remembers Michelangelo.
When he was 13, he never looked up and never watched us.
No, I wouldn't. I was shy. Yeah. I thought I wasn't good enough.
He hated himself.
What did you think about that?
We thought, Jesus, we have a problem here.
Well, there's no problem now. In fact, it's Michelangelo who does the dangerous trick of hanging by one foot under the motorcycle. He also does the most practicing on the trapeze beside the family's motor home. Of course, the other brothers practice often as well to keep up the family tradition. Young Bello has decided to take on an important role in the family, that of the clown. His act and his costume are the very same as that of his uncle, Pio Nock, in Switzerland. It's almost the same act his Swiss grandfather used.
I do the same thing as my uncle Pio, but he does it 65 to 100 feet in the air, and mine is like 11 feet off the ground. I always love clowns. I mean, at home I have ceramic clowns in cases. I have everything of clowns.
The Knocks have spent years traveling. They stay only a couple of months a year at their home in Sarasota, Florida. Mrs. Nock has to repair all the costumes on the road.
We enjoy our home in Sarasota. We have the beach, swimming pool, anything we want. That's enough. After the end of the 2-3 months, we have to start cleaning the trailer and pack the trailer. And no, it never came to my mind. I don't know. I've been traveling all my life. I was born in a caravan.
We have six people, mother and father, four boys. We all live together, we eat together, we sleep together, we work together, we play together. We've been around the world 5 times together. My youngest brother is only 13 years old. He's been around the world 4 times already. Each of us speaks at least 4 languages. I speak 4. My mom speaks 6, you know. We enjoy it. I mean, it's just great.
When you're in school, do people know what you do?
Everybody. Sure, we let them know. They think it's great. We do stuff for them. We do handstands, somersaults. Teachers think it's great. Yeah. We tell them.
So the Nock family, I mean, what a great look back. And aren't we fortunate that we have that opportunity to look back and see you when you were just all learning and Bello deciding that he wanted to be a clown.
Wanted to be a clown. And she's still in Gatlinburg. I think she's in charge of the business bureau. Dee Lundy, can you imagine back then she got a hold of it? PM Magazine was regional, but then a good story would go national.
Yes.
That one went national. And then, you know, we had recorded it, and that tape was sitting around for 30 years. And I better bring it to my local friend and digitize it before the VHS gets bad. So yeah, that's a wonderful, and it's some funny stuff on there.
So, you know, I just want to remind folks and those who maybe joined a little late. You're watching Circus History Live. This is a monthly presentation by the Circus Historical Society. Our guest is Michelangelo Nock, part of the famous Nock family, circus royalty, I call him, made up of both the Nocks and the Canestrelli family. And we're really happy to have you here. We do this every month. We hope you'll join us again for our next issue of Circus History Live. And of course, you can watch it anytime on YouTube. We also encourage you to take a look at circushistory.org, our website for the Circus Historical Society. We'd love for you to become members and get our quarterly magazine, Bandwagon, where we take a look at all kinds of circus history. But right now, I want to take a look at this picture of the family. And this, I know this was a very proud day for your dad.
Yeah, Frank Ball, I think he was a circus fan and a big time lawyer in Washington. He took this photo, and it was in Baltimore, Maryland, right? That little auditorium right next to the pier. And so that's left is John. That's Bello. That's my father, my mother, myself, and Eugene around 1983. So my father was proud. 6 sway poles. And we were performing for Mr. Coronas, the Corona family, the Coronas of Hollywood. And it was always wonderful to work for the Coronas because they were a family just like us. You know, everybody working together, you know, sticking together. And I remember the Norbu was on the show in 83, the Rodriguez. Cucciolo did his comedy trampoline that year.
Very interesting. And from the Zoppé family.
The Zoppé, this guy was amazing, and he everyone loved him. He was Italian. My mother knew him in Italy. And I think I was 15, 16, and I see this little man, but he was a world-class gymnast, and he comes in with his 454 pickup truck. He's got a special truck, and I couldn't believe it. He had to like crawl. He was so small. He had to crawl over the center ring to get in the center ring. And I was like, wow. But doesn't he have a great part in the greatest show on earth?
Right.
He's tumbling. He's world-class tumbling. And that center ring was like a minefield. It wasn't a perfect Olympic gymnastic gym. No. Those performers were amazing.
No, that scene that you're talking about, for those who've seen The Greatest Show on Earth and the Zoppé writing act, he's dressed as a little girl, actually, in that, and he does bareback riding through the use of a mechanic and so forth. But what an act.
Yeah, what an act. Alberto Zoppé is a legend.
So speaking of what an act, this is just amazing to me. You know, when I take a look at your family up there, I mean, just climbing the pole, Michelangelo, it's like, I can't even imagine what that must be like.
Well, it's, so this is my mother's last performance in 1993. And she screamed at my father, Eugen, why did you sign another contract? He's double dating. John was at another date. So left is Bello, my mother, I'm on the right. That's my father downstairs watching the show. And I remember that show because Lucas Ataide, the owner of Ataide Brothers,
sure,
flew in to party with my dad and the Zoppés and the Rosaires, but also hire acts for the winter show. I think we went there that year.
Big Mexican circus down there.
Oh, huge, huge, right? Mega, mega huge. And that is Kansas City, Missouri, that Art Deco building. And like I told you, I mentioned after the circus left, which was the Coronas again, Cheap Trick and Aldo Nova came in the next weekend. I remember, man, I want to see that concert.
So I just want to talk a little bit about the props and rigging, yeah, for lack of a better word. Now, these platforms that the pole is on, tell me a little, yes, bit about how that works, how you set it up. Obviously, a circus has a lot of things going on, but yeah, this is pretty spectacular, really, when you see it in an arena.
Well, my father and Casey Gibbs, he was part of that, inventing that water tank. Those tubs are water tanks. They're like 7 feet by 7 feet. They hold 400 gallons of water, and they were first invented. My uncle, Charles, my father, and Casey Gibbs, and the Disney show. They were made for the Disney on Parade show. So they're water tanks. And then usually we'll have, to set them up, we have pulley blocks. They're tucked in the girders. And we lift these steel poles up like a giant Christmas tree and put them in the base right there.
So again, just to kind of reiterate, so the square platform is filled with 400 gallons of water.
Correct. So that's right, gallons of water. So a number of years ago, Carolina, my wife, and I did a show for the Canadian Railroad at Turner Field in Atlanta. And they said, well, we can't hire you because there's a drought. And I said, just go to Home Depot, get me 2 pallets of sandbags, because I'm going to figure a way to do this, you know, this, get this contract. It was a great contract. Right in the middle, this private party in front, inside of Turner Field. So it was such a drought that year in Atlanta. They had helicopters circling to make sure nobody was wasting water. So we put those sandbags in there and they worked just fine.
So, circus families do get together. And yeah. At one point you find your love with another act.
There she is, the Flying Espanas. And that's Carolina's two sisters. To the left is Gladys, Irene, and Carolina to the right. And I was a young boy. Carolina's a little bit older than me. It was 1977, and we were at Paul Kay's St. Louis, seven-ring Busch Stadium Circus. I wasn't even working. 1977, I was probably in the Airstream, you know, doing something. I remember my dad coming to the trailer and going, Aurelia, you got to see this new act from Mexico. These two sisters and a brother. Everybody started talking about them. And I would just hear things. Then my uncle Joe Bauer and Bill Hall had this agency called Bauer Hall Enterprises. And if you wanted to work in Monte Carlo or Europe, you had to go through those guys. Bill Hall had the connections. So I've got more props. This is an award Carolina won in Spain. And that's Carolina and the Flying Espanas, the original Flying Espanas. And Bill Hall and my uncle signed them up. They got work everywhere. And then I didn't really, I forgot the summer of 91. I'm doing a show at the Stanleyville Theater in Busch Gardens. And all of a sudden, Carolina comes to visit. One of her family members were on the show. And then we went to the, I forgot what the water park was. And after that, you know, swimming all day, we got together, got married. And we have two beautiful kids, Angelina, my daughter, and Cyrus. They're Mex-Tex kids, and we're proud of them.
Yes, you should be too. They're terrific entertainers themselves. But before that, you took on a new prop that you started to enact with.
Well, around 93, the two guys who invented this act, the Peters brothers. In fact, I've got Marco Peters. The Peters brothers invented the act, the double wheel act, and then Marco and Philip put the tigers in the wheel. Remember that? That was unheard of. And I have Marco Peters' whip right here.
Wow.
It was all for effect. But that's Carolina and I.
I believe I was still sharing the screen so you can show that again.
Oh, the whip?
Yes.
Yeah, the whip. Marco Peters' whip for the, I get all these things like gifts. I'm it's like living history. I got the Hugo Schmidt hook. And the whip from the Peters, yeah.
Now tell me about that Hugo Schmidt bull hook there.
Yeah, so the story goes that, my great-grandmother was Austrian, and during the war, there it is, Hugo Schmidt. During the war, World War II, my grandmother hid some of the Schmidt family in her caravan, and she spoke German, and the Nazis came looking for them. You know, they went around looking for gypsies, you know, circus people, whatever. Who knew who they were looking for? Right. And she said in German, she was an older lady, what do you boys want here? And they said, nothing, Mom. So Hugo Schmidt remembered that. And when she came here in 1956, he gave her an acre of property across the street from his property on Howell Avenue. And then he also gave her his bullhook.
So for those who may not know, Hugo Schmidt, longtime elephant trainer, German, was at the Hagenbeck Park in Hamburg during World War II. It was bombed and he saved the elephants. They were later taken to Sweden. John Ringling North acquired Hugo Schmidt. And their little circus history in about 15 seconds there.
But, you know, like when you, like that double wheel act, Marco and Philip sold it to my father, you know, I acquired it. And then it's given us longevity. You asked before, how do we keep going? Well, it's the people around you. When I started, you know, I had my mother and father, my three brothers, then my cousins, my uncles. And then now the last, you know, since my father died, well, since 91, I have my wife, my two kids, and, you know, we just enjoy the business. And then you always have to upgrade yourself or reinvent yourself. But see, you don't know it yourself until your wife goes, Mike, you have to upgrade yourself. Really? What, got any ideas? So you listen to people, see?
So let's take a look at one of the ways that you upgraded yourself.
Yeah.
family here, right?
Yeah. So this is the Mid-South Fair, Libertyland, Memphis, Tennessee. I always looked up to Bob Maxwell. He had Bob Maxwell's All-American Divers. And Bob Maxwell was a great producer. And he had like as many Six Flags parks as there are in the world. He had a dive show in each park, and it was the All-American Divers. So in 93, I was going to lift an idea, steal an idea. It was the Nerveless Nox All-American Thrill Show. So I came up with this concept of these Captain America costumes. So that's at the left is me. There's John, Sandra. That's Jenny, Bello, and Larry Clark the Clown. I think that was one of his first jobs, Larry Clark. He was from Memphis. If you look him up, he's a Shrine Circus producer now. He's a famous clown. And he's a friend of
ours. Jenny is Bello's wife there. For those
Bello's wife, and that's P.O. Nock's granddaughter in the center there, Sandra. Yeah.
Great. Terrific. Look, and then that's the platform, right?
There it is again. The water tank.
Yeah, it looks like a stage of some sort, but it's full of 400 gallons of water.
Of water, and it's just a clean setup. I've set that up at the Alamo. You know what I love about the circus? When somebody, they'll say, you can't do a circus here. And then, but if the guy who's in charge of the Alamo goes, go ahead, we want you to do a circus. Okay, it's always the guy who likes the circus. He opens the door for you.
So here's a great picture at Tommy Bartlett in the Wisconsin Dells. Right? Or is this in Pigeon Forge?
No, that's Lake Delton, Wisconsin Dells, 2012. Yeah. So, Carolina's up there. My wife, Carolina Spagna, on the right. On the left is Angelina Knox's first performance in 2012. And I'm taking the picture. And that was a great day. So Angelina,
how do you practice this act? I mean, you know.
Well, Angelina's a world-class water skier, right? She grew up in the water. But we start with like the top piece, maybe 2 feet off the ground. And Carolina did all the training. She has Angelina do a handstand. And then I'll set up a 6-foot pole. Then Angelina will go up there, and then Carolina will teach her all the exchanging routine, the hand routine, the ballet. And then from there, anything higher, 20, 30 feet, you start going up with a safety line. And then you work, you practice a couple years with a safety line. And then there you go. That was her.
Cyrus and his mom, right?
Yeah, there's Cyrus. He was doing clowning for a while. So we went to Muscat, Oman. That's called the Vortex of Doom. That's a Centron act. So we just came up with some goofy name for it. But look at Carolina, mother, son. She's working with everybody. Carolina's is like my mother. She can do everything, and she makes all our costumes. For instance, when the disco era was done and I started gaining weight, I said, Carolina, I can't wear a disco tight-fitting costume. So I looked at some magazines and I said, Steve McQueen, Formula One costume. So she made me a Formula One costume. I go to the Texas Motor Speedway And we work with Jeff Gordon. He goes, "Where'd you get your costume?" And I went, "My wife made it." You know, he thought it was, you know, where did you, Simpson? No, my wife made it. But Cyrus is a talented kid. He was 3 years old when he performed in the Globe of Death. Then the Sultan of Oman.
3 years old?
3 years old. We would train with him after the 1 o'clock show. Before, right when the show was done, we only had so much time to stick him in the globe. Of course, I would stand in there, or a friend of ours would stand in there with this little kid with a 50 motorcycle. And the audience wouldn't leave. They're watching this kid. And the owner of the Tommy Bartlett show, Tom Deal, you know, Tom Deal.
I do.
Yeah. He says, "Mike, if he doesn't get hurt, can we put him in the show?" Sure. But then we got invited to Muscat, Oman. His name was Sultan Qaboos. And he loves Cyrus. And we flew over there 3 times. They treated us like, you know, just wonderful. It was great.
That's fantastic. Well, you know, last January, a lot of us had the opportunity to see you and your daughter on national television.
Wow.
America's Got Talent. Actually, America does have talent, and they've recognized the Nock family on a few occasions. But let's take a look at when you were on America's Got Talent this past January. We'll just kind of let this thing roll. We're going to take your questions in a little bit also. So here we go. Really fantastic, Mike. I mean, truly, you know, most people at this age are thinking about retiring a little bit, but you're still out there doing it a lot. I mean, where all have you been this year?
Yeah, I mean, I took some time off because my mom passed away, but you know, we were in Lake City, Florida. It never ends, right? We were in California. I went out west a lot. You know, I perform at many state fairs. You know, Illinois State Fair, Oregon State Fair. It's beautiful out there. It's great to travel. You know, you wonder how long can you keep doing it? But I'm still good. I think like it's 1982. I may not look like I'm from 1982, but it's no problem.
But so if you have questions for Michelangelo, we would love to hear from him. We'll take him in the chat room if you'd like to ask him some questions. And I'll go ahead and just kind of say that, you know, you obviously have left the nerveless stock in very good hands with both your daughter and your son, with your niece and others in the family who have also continued on. Tell me a little bit about the situation in Switzerland, because I know that you still have family over there that perform too, but the circus isn't really what it was at one point, right?
Yeah, I believe my uncle closed the show, Circus Nock. But like Pio Nock's grandson, Sasha Kurt, his mother was Isabel Nock, and Isabel was the daughter of Pio, and for 45 years, she was on the wire with her father, P.O. Nock, and she worked on Ringling, but her son is still thriving. He's a theatrical producer, comedian, Sasha. Freddie Nock is an amazing daredevil. You know, he walks over the Swiss Alps. So yeah, Europe is, they're still doing good over there.
Yes, they are.
A lot of our family got into the carnival business. But the carnival business over there, you know, they have those big Ferris wheels, the roller coasters, you know, Swiss and German style. It's beautiful stuff. So a little bit of change.
So we do have a question here from Paul. I think that's Paul Guthel, who says, the Knox who did the Paterson, New Jersey Great Falls Festival for Arthur Duchek. Was that you?
I think John went out there.
Okay.
But you mentioned a great guy, Arthur Duchek. He was on the Disney show. He was Mickey Mouse on the motorcycle high wire. Arthur Duchek was in the same display as Eunice. He worked in the same display as my mother, the Canestrellis. He actually, my father was sort of a gigolo on the Ringling show. So then Arthur was Austrian. So when my dad started dating my mother, he went to my father, "This is a good girl. You better be careful." Straighten him out.
That's funny. I just want to take a moment here to talk about your mother.
Yes.
She was known to many of us, you know, in the circus world down in Sarasota. She passed away right around Thanksgiving, I think. Yes. Here's a picture of her with your lovely wife. I just want to tell you, on behalf of all of us, I hope that please, we really want you to know that we're thinking of you and your family at this time. I know that she was a very special woman, and you guys took excellent care of her also.
Took care of her, and all the glory goes to Carolina, because let's face it, it's not her mother, but Carolina accepted it. She's going to take care of my mom. And, we never shut-ins. My mom was always at our shows. At the Ohio State Fair, she was introduced in front of the audience. We'd have a chair strategically placed, and then Angelina would announce her, "Ladies and gentlemen, one of the original Nerveless Knocks," and she would take a bow, and she was doing her ballet. But Carolina, the last year, September of 2021, is when my mother with dementia really took a turn where there was no more walking, pretty much bedridden. Carolina, we put a ramp in, we got a special van, we got an easy lift. So Carolina was 100% taking care of my mother. And for all those people, the caregivers, it's unbelievable when you can take care of your own family at home. Carolina made my mom live, I would say, another year and a half, just because my mother knew where she was. This is her home, right? And then she
and your father have given us so much. One of our people who's joined us today, Bob, says that he saw you at the New York World's Fair every season at Tommy Bartlett too. Yeah. So that is a Nerveless Knock fan.
Yeah, that's a nerd. What's your last name, Bob?
It's K-A-U-N, Kahn. Kahn, I guess.
Yeah, okay. Yes, yep. How you doing? And the World's Fair, of course, I wasn't there, but when you think about it, because we were talking about Sid Croft, he was there with Puppets de Paris, and then he was on Ringling in 1947. And right,
yeah, and all Marty Croft, some of you may remember them. They did a lot of very early live programming on television, the puppets, the banana splits, HR Puff and stuff, and now. He's living, he's a friend of yours down in Sarasota, right?
Well, he lives in Hollywood. He's friends with Paul Rubens, Pee Wee Herman.
Pee Wee Herman,
native. And because of you, because there was this little window in his mind, he was 15, billed as the world's youngest puppeteer. And he worked for, Ringling Brothers. And so he's talking to me, and then I go to you, and you get all his information.
Yeah, I think like 1947, he was on the sideshow, the Ringling sideshow that season.
Just unbelievable, yeah. And then the Tommy Bartlett show, working for a guy who everybody thought he was a water skier. Tommy Bartlett never skied in his life. As you know, he was a pioneer in radio.
He was.
In his day, if you were somebody, if you were Jack Kennedy, Bob Hope, you talked to Tommy Bartlett. Tom Deal, his partner, told me a story when Tommy started doing the road shows, the Tommy Bartlett water ski show. Like, he would work for the Chicago Air and Water Show.
Yep.
They would hire him as an act and say, "Can you promote our show?" Yes, because he had all the networking. He would go on the radio and you would hire him, and then he'd become your promoter.
Yeah, he was quite a guy, and obviously. The water show closed down because of COVID.
Yeah.
And after many, many, many years in the Wisconsin Dells. Michaelangelo Nock, it's been a privilege to have you on Circus History Live today. Thank you so much. We encourage all of you to join us again next month or anytime on YouTube for Circus History Live. and support the Circus Historical Society, your opportunity to learn more about circus history by joining the CHS at circushistory.org, and you'll receive our Bandwagon, the quarterly publication, which we provide on circus history each month. Ruth, Bruce?
I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. And Michaelangelo, it was terrific. Chris, always a great job. And again, everyone, we wish everyone a great holiday season. And we will continue our series of Circus History Live in January. So again, thank you for coming. And thank you, Michael, for what a wonderful program. Great job.
Thanks. And we'll see you down the road.
Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you so much. I'm honored.
Good night.
Thank you.
That concludes this edition of Circus History Live.